Okay, we will resume our tutorial. So the topic I'm going to talk about is active crowdsourcing scenarios. So let's recap what is the active crowdsourcing usually looks like. So there are several popular commercial crowdsourcing platforms such as Amazon Mechanical Turk or Cloudflowers, and you can work use the platforms as a requester. So as a requester, you need to design the task, post them on those platforms, wait for the users to work on them, and then you collect the data from the workers, aggregate them, and pay them. As a worker, you can browse all the available tasks on those platforms. You can pick the ones that you're interested in or you're satisfied with the payment, and then you can work on those. You submit your data to the platform, and then the requester will judge the quality of your data, and you will get paid. Okay? The main difference between active crowdsourcing and passive crowdsourcing is this data collection step. So in passive, because the data are already there, and you just collect them and extract the data from the platforms, so you cannot control the data generation step. But in active crowdsourcing, you can actually design the task and sometimes design even the platforms to better collect the data. So in this tutorial, we will talk about three major topics in the data collection step. The first one is the budget allocation. So this topic is studied from the requester's perspective. So as a requester, you may have a limited budget and you need to pay the workers. So how to allocate your budget on the task or the workers to get the best result? This is the allocation, okay? The second research topic is incentive mechanism. This topic is studied from both the requester's perspective as well as the worker's perspective. A good incentive mechanism should be a win-win strategy. It would benefit both parties. And the third topic we want to cover is from the worker's perspective, how to protect the privacy of the worker so they are willing to submit their data to the platforms. The first topic, budget allocation, is very strongly motivated by the cost of active crowdsourcing. So most of the time, you will get a large data set to get labels, but you get limited budget. And those budgets need to go to both the platform as well as the workers. So for this topic, budget allocation is usually studied from two perspectives. Instance perspective and the worker perspective. So first the question is, which instance should we query for labels? That's how you allocate your budget on different tasks. And the second one is on the worker side, which worker should we choose for a certain task? And the goal for the budget allocation problem is to maximize certain type of utility, for example, the overall accuracy of the final result. In this tutorial, we will focus on the first perspective, the instance perspective. The second one is obviously very important too, but unfortunately, many commercial platforms are not support that function, so you cannot assign tasks to workers on those commercial platforms. So we will focus on the first question. So here, this is a paper published in SML 2013. And it's trying to maximize the accuracy of the result. So the main idea of this framework is to estimate the labeling ambiguity for each instance on the fly. And the reason is that if that instance is easy, then you may, the workers may give you very consensus answers, and you don't want to waste your budget on those questions. And for some highly ambiguous instances, those are hard, and the workers are very likely to disagree with each other. So you don't want to waste your budget on those questions either. So ideally, you want to put those hard questions, those ambiguous questions aside to save the budget. And if you can estimate the reliability degree of workers on the fly, then you can allocate as many labeling tasks to reliable workers as possible. Here is an example how you can maximize the accuracy. Okay, the example is on the upper left table. Suppose we have three questions, and this is the current labeling result. Question one got two positive labels, question two got one positive, one negative, and question three got one positive. And those status means the probability that this question should be positive. Okay, so now the question is, at the next step, if I can afford one more label, which instance should I pick to get that label? Okay, if you pick question one, as you can see here, it already got two positive. So no matter what label you get for the third one, you can't change the result for the majority voting, right? If it's positive, it still stays positive. If it's negative, still stays as positive. So if you choose that question, you waste that label. Okay? If you pick the second question, no matter what label you get, it will change the result. Because right now it is it's a tie, so it's unknown label. If you get positive, then the question will become positive. If you get a negative label, then this question will get a negative result. So no matter what label you will get, you will get improvement for the accuracy. And for the third one, this is interesting. If the next, if the true label is positive, then getting one more label, you will put yourself into a risk because it can be a negative label. In that case, actually the accuracy improvement is negative because you put yourself into a risk. However, if the true label is negative one, then getting this extra label here, getting this extra label here, you will give yourself a big jump for the accuracy. That's why on the figure to the right, that depends on the correct estimation of the ambiguity. If the theta 2 and theta 3 fall into the blue range, then choosing instance 2 would be your best choice. Otherwise, you should choose instance 3. Okay? So put those ideas into formulations. Suppose we have n independent binary instances, and the true labels are either positive or negative. We can define the instance difficulty. And this is defined as probability that the true label is positive, which actually means it's the relative frequency of positive one appears if you hire infinite number of workers. And obviously, if this difficulty is around 0.5, that means the workers disagree with each other very much. So this instance is hard. In the basic model, we assume that the workers are noiseless. That means the probability that a worker, a certain worker J, gave a positive value for the instance I is the same as the instance difficulty. So based on these assumptions, you can view the labels from for instance is actually IID drawn from a Bernoulli distribution with theta I as the probability. Okay. So in this problem, we can also use the Bayesian settings. So if we consider the theta is drawn from a prior distribution, which is a beta distribution, then the meaning of this beta distribution is that we have, at the initial stage, we have AI positive label counts and the BI negative pseudo labels for the ice instance. And the posterior of the beta distribution is basically you add one to the A's if you get a positive vote from the workers, or you get a B increased by one if you get a negative label from the worker. So in this opt KG framework. In it, formally, you're trying to find a policy that can maximize expected accuracy if you've taken over all the sample paths. So here, the sample paths, I means the instance, and Y means the label you get. And the stage-wise reward is depend on what label you get for the next step. So here, the IAB indicate the CDF of the beta distribution, and you can view the HIAB as the accuracy of the current stage. So if at the next stage you get an extra positive label, then the reward is the accuracy of the next stage minus the accuracy of the current stage. Same thing for the negative case. It's just you would get different rewards if you depends on what label you get. And in this framework, the author proposed a greedy strategy. That is, you get the maximum reward is the final reward instead of expected reward. So here's an example of how this framework would choose for this case. Suppose we have three questions, and this is the current labeling stage. First, you would calculate the accuracy for the current stage based on the CDF of the labeling result. And the next step is to calculate the reward. So basically, suppose I pick a certain instance and get extra label. If it's one, if it's zero, if it's one or negative one, and then you pick the maximum. And that becomes the stage-wise reward. And then the next step, you pick the instance that has the highest reward. In this case, question three would be picked because it has the biggest reward. And you continue this process until your budget runs out. And this is one thing that is under that budget, you want to maximize your quality of the labeling result. But that may not be all the case, especially when you have a tight budget, because under a tight budget, you will actually face a trade-off between quality and quantity. So here is an example. Suppose I have three questions and I can only support three labels. So of course, if I want to guarantee quantity, I would put one label for each question. However, that may not be what I want. I may be willing to sacrifice the quantity, but I want high quality if I get a label, right? So for the right case, I would sacrifice the quantity, but I will guarantee that because I put so much effort on that instance, the quality are very likely to be high. And that trade-off is balanced based on the requester's requirement. Some requesters may ask for high quality. Some askers may willing to sacrifice the quality but guarantee a higher quantity. So in this wisdom paper, we are trying to incorporate those requirements into consideration. So this framework is called Requalo, and the input also contains the requester's requirement of the quality and the budget, which is the maximum amount of label that can be afforded. And the goal for this one, different from the previous one, is that we're trying to maximize quantity instead of quality. So here, the goal for this framework is to label as many instances as possible, which achieve the requirement under that budget. So here I will give you some examples for the requirement. For example, minimum ratio, which is widely used in real life, is easy to implement. So basically, you would approve the result if an instance gets the ratio for the count bigger than a certain threshold. Under this problem setting, this is equivalent to set the threshold on the entropy. Another one can be used as a requirement is to pass certain kind of hypothesis test. For example, Fisher-Exest test can be used to test if the labels are randomly guessed. For that hypothesis test, you can calculate the p-value based on the current labeling result and approve the result if that p-value is smaller than the threshold you set. And because we're trying to maximum the quantity, so we need to measure what is the quantity. So here, the completeness is introduced. Instance completeness is defined as the ratio between the observed label vote count and the minimum count of labels it needs achieved at that requirement. So let's take a look at the example. Suppose right now I have 3 votes for the positive and 1 vote for the negative class. And the requirement is the minimum ratio of 4. So apparently this instance haven't achieved that requirement yet. So if the correct answer for this instance is positive, then we need at least 1 more label for the positive class to achieve that requirement. Therefore, the completeness of the current stage is 4/5. The 5 is that you need at least 1 more label, right? And if the true label is negative class, then you need at least 12 votes for the negative vote count, for the negative class to achieve that requirement. That's why the completeness is 4/15 here. So with this in mind, we can get the expected completeness. Sorry, it shifted a little bit. But basically, the first part is the completeness given that the true label is positive, and the second part is the completeness given that the true label is negative. Therefore, using this completeness, we can maximize the quantity for this framework. The goal, as mentioned before, is to label instances as many as possible that achieve that requirement quality. And the stage-wise reward will change. Unlike the previous one, which is the accuracy of the next stage minus the accuracy of current stage, it becomes the quantity, the expected completeness of the next stage minus the expected completeness of the current stage. And the framework also uses a greedy strategy, which picks the biggest one. Okay, the same example, but under different thoughts for the requirement. So again, this is the current labeling stage. And the requirement is minimum ratio of 3. So apparently, the first question already achieved that requirement. So the completeness is 100%. It should be off from the set. But question 2 and 3 should be considered because not achieved yet. And then you calculate the reward. So in this case, question 2 actually has a bigger reward than question 3. So question 2 will be selected to label next. The second part I want to introduce is the incentive mechanism. The goal of incentive mechanism is to design certain type of payment mechanism to incentivize workers to work for your project. And hopefully this is a win-win strategy. It would benefit both the requesters and the workers. For the requesters, you want to get the optimum utility for your expense. And for the workers, you want to get the maximum payment if you follow the rule of the mechanism. So the first one I want to talk about is published on NIPS, last year's NIPS, is a double or nothing strategy. This mechanism is built upon the current commercial platforms. So this one can be used on the Amazon Mechanical Cloudflower. So here, in this mechanism, the authors encourage the worker to skip questions about she's not unsure. The reason is that for those questions, if you're not sure about the result, then your answer, if you force them to pick one answer, then that answer is very likely to be unreliable. So instead of saying just a yes or no for this image, you put a third option, I'm not sure. And if the worker picks that option, it means, well, she's not sure about the results, so she will skip this question. And this mechanism want to achieve the goal of no free lunch. That is, if all the questions answered by the workers are wrong, then they should get zero payment. So the input of the mechanism includes a confidence threshold T. This value is between 0 and 1. It indicates a threshold for the confidence of the worker. So if the worker has higher confidence than T, she will try to answer the question. Otherwise, she will skip this question. And the budget and evaluation vector. So here, this evaluation vector is compare the worker's answer with a gold standard questions. Of course, the workers have no idea which questions are the gold standard questions. And the evaluation vector can have three values for each question, wrong, skipped, or correct. And from this evaluation vector, you can calculate the number of correct answers the worker provide and the number of wrong answers the worker provide. And the payment is given in this formulation. So let's give an example to see how this formulation would translate into language. Okay. The input for the example is that the threshold is 1/2, and the budget you get 80 cents. And you have three gold standard questions in the task. So the incentive mechanism would describe like this. So the reward start at 10 cents. For every correct answer in the three gold standard questions, the reward will double. That is, if you answer one question in the gold standard questions correct, your reward becomes 20 cents. If you get the third one correct, the second one correct, the reward will jump to 40. If you get all of them correct, the reward will jump to 80. If you skip that question, your reward would stay the same, because skip doesn't mean you answer it correctly, right? However, if any of these gold standard questions are answered incorrectly, then your reward will become zero. You will get no pay for this task. So please use I'm not sure option wisely. Okay. The mechanism is actually pretty easy to understand, which is good because you want your workers to understand what you want, and they need to follow the rule. But based on the analysis, it shows very good result. This payment mechanism is incentive compatible and satisfies the no free lunch condition. That is, this payment mechanism allows the worker to skip the ones that they're not sure of, and the workers will get no payment if they answer all the questions wrong. And further, the authors show that the payment is the only incentive compatible mechanism that satisfies the no free lunch condition. This payment mechanism also minimizes the expected payment to a worker who answers all questions uniformly at random. So that's pretty good, impressive result. Okay. The next incentive mechanism I want to talk about is actually you build a new system. So this branch of work is usually working on cross-sensing. So basically, they really build a new system that collects the data. So here, we have three workers, and they can send their sensing data to a platform. And the platform is the requester. But the platform also acts as an auctioneer, and the worker can work as the bidders. So first, the platform would announce a set of sensing tasks to the workers. And then every worker would submit a bid tuple to the platform. And the tuple includes a bidding bundle and the bidding price. The bidding bundle is the set of tasks that the worker are interested to work on. And the bidding price is the price they want to get the payment. And then the platform would determine the set of winners from the workers based on their bidding bundles and the bidding price, and then send the payment profile to all the winners. Then the winner would send the sensor data to the platform, and then the platform send payment to the winner. This is a game theory-based design of a platform. And analysis shows that if you use proper functions, this mechanism, the auction, is individual rational and truthful. So those are the game theory concept. Individual rational means the users are receiving some utility, non-negative utility for the tasks. And the auction is truthful means that each worker will submit to the platform his truly interested task, and the bidding price is actually equal to their true cost. The third part I want to talk about is the privacy concern. This research task is usually studied from the worker's perspective. So keep in mind, this is this is the mechanism of active crowdsourcing. The workers submit their data to the platforms or the requesters, and then you do the truth discovery procedure. However, there may be some privacy concerns from the worker side. For example, if the crowd is trustworthy, will my data be disclosed to other participants? And will the others know my reliability degrees? Is the communication channel secure? And those questions will affect the users if they want to upload or not. Okay. So for the privacy concerns, the privacy information contains not only the answers you submit to the platforms, but also the user's reliability. So the user's reliability degree is very sensitive because platforms can probably infer the personal information by calculating their reliability. And leakage of the reliability degree may lead to malicious manipulation of the data price. So that means on the basic aggregation model, we need to add a constraint. So here, this problem, the input and the output are still the same from the previous introduced aggregation models. The input are the labels and the output are the true labels. But here we have extra constraint, which is the label and the reliability should be kept worker private. So worker private here means that if others cannot determine that information uniquely. So here, this is a basic procedure of how those protocols would work like. So suppose we have a bunch of objects and we have users to have claims on those objects and submit to crowd to the platform. And in the previous introduced frameworks, we would have wait update and truth update, and those two would iterative update each calculation and to get the estimate truth and the weight reliability estimation. But here, when we do privacy preserving, these two steps need to be done securely. So for example, for the weight update, instead of just get all the information to the crowd, you need to the worker will encrypt the distance information. And then the worker, based on those encrypted information, it would send back the encrypted weight to the workers. And for the truth estimation, if you want to done securely, the worker will encrypt the weighted data and then send back to the crowd, send back to the requester. And the platform will then estimate the ground truth and then send back to each worker. Again, these two steps would iterative runs until the until the crowd get the estimate truth. And for those protocols, there are two assumptions, semi-honest and non-collusion. Semi-honest assumption means that the users will follow those protocols, but they will be curious. They want to infer each other's information. For the non-collusion assumption, that means all the parties would not collude outside the protocol. There are several protocols built based on the existing truth discovery and cross-source data aggregation models. For example, this one used the DS model as the base model. And then the E step and the M step would then calculate as a secure way. So at the E step, well, as the requester and the worker would estimate the truth by secure computation, and the M step would be the worker after the confusion matrix secretly. This is a PPTD protocol, which built upon the model of CRH in SIGMOD 2014. So their secure inference would occur at the weight update and the truth estimation, as we introduced earlier. So now I will talk about some applications and some open questions still occurs in the cross-sourcing scenarios. So here, we divided the cross-sourced data into two groups, active and passive. But there are actually a lot of applications kind of in the middle, blurred the boundary between active and passive. So here, as we talked about earlier, we found that the passive cross-sourcing is usually collect passively and have an open domain answering space. And for the active cross-sourcing, we find that it's usually actively collected and have a closed domain answering space. But all of these applications we listed here are kind of mixed. It can be actively collected, but has an open domain answering space. For example, the wisdom of the cloud. We actually build a smartphone app based on the game show Who Want to Be a Millionaire. Everybody heard about that game show? Okay. So this app will actually send the question when the show is on live, and the app user can play along with those players on the TV and send back their answers. Okay. So we collect those data. We run for one season of Who Want to Be a Millionaire and get more than 2,000 questions. Those questions are really asked on the TV. And we have more than 30,000 app users who really play the game when the game show is on live. And we collect more than 200,000 answers. And as showed earlier, the error rate of the truth discovery method can reduce can be reduced greatly, more than half compared with majority voting. So this is an example. You will get questions and the candidate answers on your phone app, and then you can play along. Okay. For this application, you can see it is actively collected. You really query the users to give you answers. However, the answering space is open. It's, by open, we mean, well, even though it's categorical, A, B, C, D, but A, B, C, D have totally different meanings for different questions. So for this question, A is 16, but for next question, A probably changed to Barack Obama or something else. So estimating a confusion matrix in this case doesn't make sense, because if the correct answer is B and you choose A, it should change from question to question. It's no longer like a dog, cat for every instance. In this case, every question would have different answer space. So here we would we should consider this probably as active crowdsourcing, but with open domain questions. And the second application is a slot filling application. This is first collected by a paper in computational linguistics. So this data set is extracted from slot filling validation task of this text analysis conference. And it is a competition. So each there are several teams that would do the competition together. And each system in the competition can be viewed as a data source. And each slot filling query can be viewed as object. Of course, the goal is still to find the best slot filling results. And we can see that actually the truth discovery helps a lot when combining those systems results. So on the upper left table, this is example questions of the slot filling task. So the questions like, what is the age? What is the country of birth? What is death date for a person? So again, those questions is actively asked. So you actually collect the data actively. However, the answering space is open. You don't know how many answers you will get when you collect the data. And you have no idea how conflict they will be, even how many characters they will be. So at the bottom table, this is a result from Zhi's KDD paper, last year's KDD paper, and shows that if you use proper truth discovery method, you will pump your F1 score greatly compared with like voting methods. The third task is this indoor floor plan reconstruction. So this one is motivated by the automatic floor plan construction systems. Those systems will try to infer the information of about the building floor plan from the movement trees of group of smartphone users. Because you are indoor, they wouldn't get GPS signals. So those would actually, the location of a user would determine by like Wi-Fi fingerprints and those stuff. And this those systems actually attract a lot of research attentions because there are a lot of location-based phone apps. For example, if you go to a mall and you stop by, say, Macy's, and then Macy's may send you a coupon to encourage purchase. So those systems will help to locate the user where you are right now in the mall. Okay. So one specific task in the indoor floor plan reconstruction is to estimate the distance of between two points, for example, a hallway segment. So we developed a phone app that can estimate the walking distance of a phone user. So basically, the phone user will carry the phone, install those apps, and then walk around. And we will collect their walking distance for those segments. We have more than 200 volunteers participate in our experiment and walking around in the building at our department. We collect the data for our 100 segments. And we use this data set to test our truth discovery method because every user have a different walking pattern and different ways of carrying the phones. So their readings actually differs quite a lot. And we, if to aggregate them, we will get a better estimation of the segment length. So here we show this result in our this year's KDD paper. We estimate the distance and measure, we actually using a tape to measure the segments of the hallway to get the ground truth values, and we compare the results of our algorithm output and the ground truth. So you can see here, actually, compared with previous data sets, this is a continuous data. So instead of saying error rate, we need to measure the distance. For example, here the MA indicates the mean absolute error, and the RMSE is the root of mean square error. And we can see using proper truth discovery method, those distance would decrease quite a lot. And the more detail of this result will be presented in our poster session. So welcome to stop by.
Hi, I will finish the tutorial by giving you guys a natural application. And we're building Baidu research in Sunnyvale, that's nearby, and an actual robot. And can diagnose you know, health issues. You can query the robot, and the robot will ask additional questions, clarify, then give you a diagnosis on possible disease. And I will show a live demo at the end. And okay, here is, before I go through some detail, here is some reason why we actually do this, okay? And I have some real numbers in here, okay? Like in China, and there's, according to the Bureau of Statistics, and nearly 80% people, the netizens, you know, that's a Chinese word, is the people having access to the internet. When they do not feel well or have a health care concern, the first place they go get answers actually on the internet. Because, you know, obviously you won't talk to your friend about you have a rash in your back. That's very, very weird. And also in China, in the urban cities, 70% of people actually do have some health issues, either minor or big. But in China, and you know, because we have a shortage of doctors, and only about 5% of people eventually go see a doctor. You know, the most of the time they either recover at home or just ignore it, and hopefully they will, you know, not get any even worse. In the U.S., we are lucky we have a PCP, but most of the time, you know, unless you have a very bleeding situation, you won't see your PCP probably in 2 weeks, right? Okay. So in both in China and the U.S. now, we have a lot of the verticals. In the U.S., we have a WebMD, and drugstore.com, and Mayo Clinic as well also have a website. You can have a, right now, the most popular one is you have a single a bodygram. So you click a single body part. For example, I have a headache. Then you click on the head, and there's a drop-down menu with a lot of terms, and many are actually very professional. And some of the terms you may not even understand, because if you know the term already, you are a doctor. In the same time, you know, you cannot choose a multiple symptom easily either. So sometimes you really have a frustration. It tells you something you don't even care, or tells you you have a disease you don't think you even have. But anyway, so the point is, there's a high demand in right now in China, also in the US, you know, for people to get health information on their hand very quickly, okay? So traditionally, you do a search online because we are so non-professionally medical. You probably only search on the most obvious symptom you have, such as I have a fever and I have a headache, okay? And I may not pay attention, I may have a rash on my back, or I have other important symptoms. The doctor may ask you, but since you are non-professional, you won't even notice, okay? Then you search online, you get some queries back. You can do the same thing right now on Google and see what happens. You may have a ton of information coming back. You may have to read many, many pages to find out, oh, this sounds like and relevant. Then I refine my query. Okay, add another symptom in there. You get another tons of you know, pages back. Then eventually, hopefully, you will solve your issue. Okay, and so that's not very efficient. So, but in the same time, you know, so you really want something like you know, now AI is such a buzzword, you know, in the world now. You know, Google, Baidu, and many companies are Facebook are investing heavily. So same thing in Baidu, and AI is one of our main strategies. So anyway. The key point is healthcare is a big demand, and the traditional search engine is not very good at giving you the answer you need. So you need to really leverage what we have already online. Okay, see? So these are the many of the healthcare and websites we have already, and I'm just listing a few. And both in Chinese and in English. And so this one, very popular one in China, and it's called Seek Medication, Seeking Help. So you post your question online, and if you list all your important symptoms, and that's good, then you may get some answer back from doctor or from your other co-patient, okay? And these are something very similar we have in the US as well. And just for your benefit and see what kind of thing you can find now these days. And for example, my husband got a quintuple heart bypass surgery a year ago. They had this weird, you know, pain in his left leg and where the vein is removed. And then the pain is so bad, so the doctor don't seem to know even the reason because such a rare, you know, occurrence. Then he got a pain reliever, didn't seem to work. Then blah, blah, okay. Then there are a lot of comments by other people. So another patient experiencing similar situation as well, and got a prescription drug, but then he got another side effect because probably some interactions, you know, you have older, you're probably taking other drugs as well, then all these kind of things. Anyway, so obviously there's, then we come to the bottom line of you have many information online, as well as all this, you know, years of Western, you know, medication, Western medical books, okay? Then how to leverage the online information as well as medical information to build a robot which can understand you and help you is very important, okay? Then, okay, I just list out like some of the challenges we solve. We actually have a paper coming out, and actually in one transaction of IEEE have some of the details. And so we have a lot of long tail issues, and isn't really solved very well because common code, I guess you may have a lot of these kind of things and you don't really care, but you have a lot of, because the ICD-10 disease classification have altogether more than 10,000 different disease. And many disease you probably never heard of, but they do occur. And about 500 of the disease, the occurrence rate is about 93%. And so there's a long tail issue, and you have a lot of common cases, a lot of rare cases as well, and then how to leverage all the information you find online, also leveraging the professional literature to get all the truth information to do diagnosis are really challenging. And then in the same time, you know, the same symptoms can have multiple disease. You know, I have a cough and fever, and it can be a common cold, and then the less pleasant one can be bronchitis. Then very weird one can be a TB, you know, if you really have got infected, okay. So then, so basically, in we invent an iterative procedure like computing the weight of the reliable weight of different sources, then combine them together. And so we have the raw data, then we do the entity extraction to have the disease and the drugs and symptoms. Then we build a knowledge base. And from this knowledge base, as well as our inference engine, which is mostly rely on Bayesian network, because the basic assumption is, and we have all these different hypotheses. One hypothesis is when the patient have a disease, it's a conditional distribution over the symptoms. Then we, based on what we know, then we ask the most relevant question from the network, and also in the same time understanding the what are given already and the disease distribution, as well as we put in the information we found online to tune the parameters in the network to do the diagnosis. Anyway, I think I'm going to just jump to the demo very quickly, which is actually more real. Yeah, so, yeah, here I just put one. I'm sorry, it's in Chinese. And yeah, because our Baidu's market is mostly in China, but I will do my best to translate, okay? So here in the beginning, so the demo is called Do Nurse, and because you can we never want to claim we are going to replace doctor, even though actually we did a blind test, and we're using almost over 200 and senior medical students, including the 20 top tier AAA hospitals in China. And the AAA in China means something like Mayo in the US in that level, like Concord in Beijing. And so our current system, like we tested over 200 diseases and our different traits. And our current system are 80% identical to the majority of the medical doctor. But in the same time, so we put a blind test. So it's like a Turing test, okay? So the doctor and will label their own colleague prediction, also our product. And the good news is 90% of the time, the doctor couldn't distinguish between the robot and also the own colleague. So meaning that, and with some effort, and we can probably pass the Turing test in some ways, okay? But anyway, so we are not claiming that we are going to replace the doctor because no matter how good we are, we haven't passed the medical bar test, okay? So anyway, so here is just one simple one starting with. So the question is, I bleed when I brush my mouth. Then, so the question and the first one is, how old is the patient? And so like click myself, so 45 and 60. Then ask the gender of the patient. So I say it's a male. Then I ask you some relevant symptoms. And then the symptoms can be, we actually have leverage both the information online when people are talking about the same disease, and we compute their what are the most common symptoms and their significance. And even the average different symptom also have a different way of saying it. Particularly in Chinese, you know, the fever, we have probably like 20 different ways of saying it in China because we have 56 different provinces. And it's a rich language, I'm sorry, but that make NLP very, very hard. Also making crowdsourcing very important. So then the question is, do you have a bad appetite? Do you have a, is your tooth moving, and is your gum swelling, and or I just don't know, or I don't have anything. So let me just click on my my gum is swelling. Then I ask you additional question like, do you have some tooth that the position is not correct? And do you have a recession of your gum? And do you have a calcium? Do you have ever developed calcium on your tooth? Well, I don't know, or I don't have anything. Let's say my gum is recessing, okay? Then I ask you, you know, some histories. Disease histories, these are getting very, very like professional, like do you have some disease in the past? And I don't know, I'm sorry, there's fancy names in medical, so I say I don't have any of these, okay. Then they ask you some living habit. Do you always get food stuck in your mouth? And actually I do. And do not clean your mouth very well? And did you ever have a cavity and being repaired before as well? So I say yes as well, okay. Then it gives you the disease and the medical card in there. So the first one is periodontal disease. Does it sounds right in English? Okay, and the second one is gingivitis. Then we are still enriching that by working with actually medical professionals. Because in medical, and you have to be responsible for what you do. So when we crawl information, we actually, all the medical car information, we work with the medical top tier medical hospitals in China and the US, then they have to endorse us. And that's very important, okay. Then, okay, so just to make it this more interesting, let me start. I think I have to just a little bit server issue because server is in China now. Yeah, let me just refresh this. Yeah, so let me just prepare some question here. Yeah, so the question is, I say my baby having a fever and have a blister on mouth and hand. Yeah, now it's because it's a recurrence profile. And now because it was me who was between 45 and 60. And obviously, it's my baby, so it's figured out. So as you know. And ask me the range, the how old is the kid, and I say 2 and 5 years old. And then I ask you, and how frequent is the fever? And I say it happened often recently. And then ask you the dimensional question, which is extremely important in medical diagnosis, like how high is the temperature? And for a child, usually they have because they high much high higher metabolism rate than adults. So usually 38.5 is important one. So I say it's more than 35.5. I click on that. It asks you like how long the baby have the fever. I say more than a day. Then they ask me. Yeah, additional question like. Is the baby like having saliva coming out, feel nauseated, have a running nose, and I say that the baby doesn't have all of these. Then ask a usual question like, is the baby have no strains and bleeding somewhere and, you know, doesn't have. Then ask you like, doesn't have a good appetite. Does it recently have any infections, or the food and hand are cold? And I say it doesn't have. Then ask you a different question, and it feels bad in the stomach, and doesn't pee very often. And so you can see it gets very detailed, and ask you is the has a baby been losing weight and recently has diarrhea that have a blister on the mouth and hand, as confirming what I said in the very beginning, and has had blister on the hand and the mouth. Then ask you, have the baby recently have any friend who has a foot and a mouth disease? That's a very serious one and need to be taken care of professionally. You cannot treat foot and mouth disease at home. It's very, very contagious as well. And has the baby been eating any dirty food or have contracted anything unclean? And I say yes. And is the baby, you know, extremely hygienic? Of course, it's not. So I say the baby is, you cannot tell what happens when your baby is in kindergarten, right? And I click on this, then ask you some additional question. Has the baby experienced cold recently? And is the mother feeding the baby well, and I say everything's okay. Yeah, then tells you the disease. So we only provide two. So the first one and is hand and mouth disease. That's a viral infection that needs to be treated. And even then, we also tells you where the family belongs to. In terms of the family in medicine, then the less likely one can be a common cold, and then gives you information on how you can take care of it. So this type of things. Yeah, so click on that, and it shows you the medical card. These are provided by medical professionals, like the common cause of the disease, symptoms, and how this should be taken care of. So these are particularly for in China because. Still having this unfortunate one-child policy, but so most mother and young parents don't live with their parents, so they are having no experiences in taking care of the baby. So you have something like this one, ask you extremely helpful, because you really don't have to go to a hospital and unless you really need to. But in the same time, you know, you get information very quickly, like a human experience instead of doing the search online. Yeah, just so let me move back. And so I think we are going to, towards the end of it. And so, yeah, so there are a lot of nice resources. And I won't just go through all them in detail. And so Jing, Professor Gao, will put the slides on her website. Then you can search. That's where you may, anybody who's interested, and can, you may want to take a picture of it. And so Jing, all the staff will be there. And for people interested in our demo, actually should be live in our product. In the, you are lucky, and within a week. You sound unlucky, maybe in 2 weeks, because anybody from internet company, you know, you put down something online, have worry about intrusion, spam detection, and servers available or overloading stuff. And since we have, I think, actually we run a little bit fast. We have about 20 minutes or so. And Professor Han and Seth Redier, we open up the floor for a QA session. And so all the speakers are still here. Then ask, you know, any details if we ran too fast, or just any, you know, applications you're working on, or something we just can help with. Thanks so much.
Okay, so thanks for staying in our tutorial. So as Wei mentioned, we have like 20 minutes left. So we will open the floor for questions and answers. So all the speakers are here. So one of us or more of us will answer your question. So I think the question is like, so by single worker, I think you mean that the workers are independent, right? So workers independently provide their response to questions. But actually, as we mentioned, that there is a line of work that handle the so-called source correlation. So if we consider a worker as an information source, then there are work that indeed consider that the workers are not independent. So there are workers that may work together. And also, and there are kind of, like two types of work. So some assume that you know their relationships. So for example, you know beforehand that these workers are a team and these workers and another team. So you can take that information into this framework to like do this aggregation. And there is another line of work where people assume that you don't know this kind of relationship, so you can automatically detect that which set of workers typically give similar answers, then they probably work as a team. So there are indeed some work like working in that dimension. But indeed, there are still some work that have that assumption, which is kind of practical in unlike some Amazon Mechanical Turk or some online crowdsourcing platform, because these workers are just independently give out responses. Did I answer the question?
Thank you very much. In the beginning, I've noticed that you are working in data mining in isolation of other fields. Like, for example, Doctor just presented something related to institutional effectiveness model of 1991 in a different format. So this is, and then in the beginning, item response theory was presented in a different format as well. So I think the integration among other disciplines is very important. And I would like for the last presenter to thank very much for this one. But now technology had been developed into apps format. Since we are talking about validity and reliability of data sources, what if the people have disability in terms of dyslexia or any other thing? Their input to your questions will not be very much valid, you know? So we have to have something for these people in terms of those, especially those who have sight problems, hearing problems. So they have to have incorporated their inputs in a valid and reliable manner. Thanks.
Okay, so is that a question or comment? So I think thank you for the comment that we also, all of us really believe that this work we talk about has lots of applications. And we talk about some applications today, but I believe people can find more applications. Actually, during the coffee break, someone approaches me and discusses some other applications, and I really feel that there are a lot of applications. And about the work you mentioned, so there is definitely, because its basic idea is to aggregate information from different sources, so I believe indeed there are lots of related work in different domains. As you mentioned, some work even from can date it back to like really old days. So we actually also check these literatures, like the item response theory you talk about, we also have checked those work. And I think there are still slight differences. For example, the work Bo talk about, it assumes like the answers from a fixed domain, like closed, kind of closed domain. But later when we apply to crowdsourcing scenario, actually the answers can be open space. So therefore this crowdsourcing indeed motivates some new challenges, and therefore we are working towards this goal. So I think the other speakers can also flag in. Just me answering questions.
So there were a bunch of places where there were assumptions that the error was normalized and unbiased. Has there been any work on modeling the error to actually look at that? I think especially where you're talking about sensors and stuff, you'd actually go, oh, this user is keeping the sensor in the back pocket or whatever.
I think this still seems a question to me. So if I understand the question correctly, you're talking about that air quality work we did? Okay. The setting of that work is, so each user carry a sensor and they report the sensoring results at each location. I think your question is like, the sensor could have some bias, right? So different user, the sensor may have different bias. Actually, this bias is part of our consideration of this source reliability. So source reliability is kind of like a general idea, like whether the sensor works well or not. And also it depends, the source reliability also depends on how this user like walk around, carry the sensor. So actually you factor all these factors into this source reliability concept, but we didn't separate them individually, right? So that's how we consider this work. So we just say this general source reliability, if the sensor is correct and the user walk properly, then this source reliability is higher. Yeah, but as I mentioned, maybe we can also consider to fine grain, like. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So I think it would be a good idea if we can separately count these source reliability, like whether the source reliability is attributed to how this user carried, how the sensor works. So whether the sensor has high bias or low bias, blah, blah. Yeah.
Question specifically for the health domain. How precise the results are any particular values? And secondly, suppose my app outputs a very severe disease and after going to a doctor, it comes out to be a normal. So is it a potential like sort of loss of business like thing?
So Wei, this is a question for you. Are you?
So
So my question is, like, any particular values regarding the precision of the this system? And secondly, suppose your app says a very severe disease has come after inputting the symptoms, but actually when a person visits to a physician, he comes to know that it's pretty much normal. So is it like a potential loss of business for the app makers? For the loss of business for the company?
Information only, and in the same time, so we always are very sensitive, like in the type of the terminology we use when we give information. That's almost like you, when you do a search on Google, if you do not provide the correct information, if you are misinformed, can you still Google? Obviously, you can't, right? Right. How about what? The accuracy, so right now, as I mentioned, we actually have four rounds of medical tests. It's a blind test. It's done not by us, by independent organization within our company. We have recruited over 200 medical professionals and tested the current system. We cover 406 diseases. And so we are 80% identical to the majority of the doctors. So even sometimes the same symptom, even doctors have a different opinion. And yeah, so we're 80% identical to the majority of the doctors. So we already, for the same one, we have really cool three doctors, and they do not know each other. They are A, B, and C. Then if we are the same and as the two doctor, we think we are right. And we are the same with only one, we think we are wrong. And may not be true, because maybe the third one can be so fabulous, right? And but in the same time, we also did another test, like the doctor and the label their own colleague, also our system, to see if they can distinguish between the human and the robot. And more than 95% of the time, they can't, right? So meaning that, I think that, so basically the bottom line is the doctor feel that the question we ask are very reasonable, they are making sense, and also think the diagnosis we give at least are reasonable as well, given what the patients have provided, right? Yeah, thanks. Yeah. Yeah, in the U.S. one, you can. There's one recent one. The closest one we can compare is called Anna Rochter. You can take a look, and yeah. So yeah, you can take a look. Let me know how you think about it. Right.
Thank you very much for the nice tutorial. And the question I have is in the first. Four parts of the tutorial is about some more general crowdsourcing systems, right? Answering questions, relatively simple. But the last one, okay, is more domain specific, okay, about medicine and medical data, and there are sequence of questions related to following on. So I would like to know more how, for example, the techniques that have been developed for the more general crowdsourcing systems can really help this more domain specific crowdsourcing system. Thank you.
So actually, this healthcare part, so the it belongs to a category of this crowdsourced question answering. So basically, we have many questions, but these questions are medical related, right? And basically, through these online health communities, users can submit their answers to these questions, right? So in order to apply the techniques we develop, basically, the first step here is to this pre-processing. So you need to extract the questions and the answers from this text. So I think this was done in Wei's group. So they work, they have a team basically developing all these extraction techniques to extract all these claims. So we call it claims. So basically it's users' answers to these questions. And then on top of these claims, so then we basically can formulate as a truth finding kind of problem, right? So for each question, so you may have different claims, and then we can apply our techniques to this data set to find out basically detect the true answers. And I think there are other components in Wei's work, yeah.
To building a real system, people who are, I don't know, people here from Google, from Facebook, they know it's much more complicated than talking about academic papers. First of all, the data not only have the truth mining issue, they also have a huge sample selection bias issue because people self-select, right? So really, so I would say that the truth mining in terms of the medical diagnosis, I think the most important value is it provides the for those, I haven't shown something yet, we also have a non-medical related, non-serious diagnosis question. So for example, if your baby tend to vomit milk, and what can you do? Even asking a doctor, they probably wouldn't. Can, if you ask 10 doctors, you may have 10 different answers. But they are the type of information you have a lot of experiences share online. So these are these kind of things, and the truth mining are more useful. But in the same time, and also the medical book, they have all the professional terms, you know, and we can be so different in our colloquial way. So the truth mining, basically, we get the data, then we do the NER extraction, then we find how reliable they are to start with. Then after we do the NER extraction, you have to build a model to how to classify the non-standard and terms to standard ones. So for example, in fever in China, I can say, you know, have a huge fever, small fever, have your heat on my head, you know, so many different ways because and people in China understand because China we have different provinces and people have their own dialects as well and like India I think better than India have different languages okay then so this type of thing then the actually the whole diagnosis part we actually most rely on Bayesian network and the simple reason is this is very different from the data-driven approach, because the online data, as I mentioned, have the not only reliable issue, and we are talking about now, and also the PX issue, the sample selection bias issue. And by medical literature, all the prior hypotheses are known already. Then the question is given on what we know from the user, and then and how to you based on the conditional distribution, how you can sort out the most likely one. But in the same time, you have to ask the right question in the same time. And the question also needs to be logical, because for a system, simple, like everything is a symbol, right? If you're, you know, sometime asking something about my head, then you ask something about my belly, then head back again. And for a human experience, that's very bad. You feel the robot is brain dead. So all these type of issues, you know, are important. So I would say like truth mining, I would say about 20-30%. Then the other thing is sample selection bias, statistics. And we also use a lot of like deep learning as well. And I didn't mention. And traditional NLP and graph mining, spectral, like graph Laplacian and the type of things. And yeah, when the product finally come out, and maybe in the future we can give a tutorial as well, and also we are going to release the most important part of the inference engine. We have a Bayesian network is people working like NP hard, and if we have in China we have such a big population, so the system has respond, you know, very quickly, and so how to do that very quickly is very important as well. Yeah, thanks. Yeah, go ahead. Is it a way to capture the feedback? Yeah, we actually do. And when we put initially online, I think people from Google, Facebook understand it, so we have to be very careful. Because you know, we did test with from end user and also medical professionals. And because to see products is very different to B. I used to come from IBM and Huawei. I'm working on, this is my first 2C job. And so we keep maintaining all the log, and people can also give feedback as well. The feedback also be very carefully treated, because they can give a feedback right away that may be just based on the experience of the product, but may not be on the actual answer of the medical. It's like you buy something on Amazon. And that process, if you give feedback, it's about the shopping process. It's not about how much you hate or like the camera you bought, right? So we have been very sensitive on the type of distinguish, you know, the experience of the product, but in the same time, you know, the quality of the medical. And so the medical quality, obviously, is the most important thing. That one will rely more by collaboration with the medical hospitals in China, also in the US as well, to help us out.
So first, thanks for the tutorial. So I have two questions. Given you have so many works on crowdsourcing, I want to ask you about two beliefs in crowdsourcing. The first belief is that, do you believe that the more complicated you model worker and the task, the better quality you achieve? You know that existing works mainly differ in different worker models, and some works model only a value for worker, and some works model of matrix, a confusion matrix, and some other works model a work of different domains, where the domains of different granularities. So do you believe that the more complicated you model a worker or a task, the better quality you'll get? And the second belief is, the second question is related to the belief in the active crowdsourcing. That is, do you believe that the more answers we collect from the workers, the better quality we will get? Or, for example, when we collect a certain number of answers, for example, around 100 answers from workers, then the more you will collect, then the quality will remain steady, will not increase. So thanks, just these two, yeah, belief.
So the first question is regarding like how many parameters you have for the model, how complicated it is. So right now the models are getting more and more complicated, but in real life they claim that they can work better, but doesn't mean that a simple model doesn't work. So you can see the DS model is published in 1979. It is not that parameters for the to evaluate for the model, and it is still a strong baseline for crowdsourcing aggregation, and most of the time it still works very well. So of course, if you have extra information, that can help, but at the same time, there comes a cost of if your data can support such a big model. For the second question, so right now, we consider the budget. So more likely, you wouldn't want to waste the extra effort if you think it becomes stable. That's why in those models, if you get enough labels from the worker, well, actually, the reward will reduce very dramatically. So you wouldn't relabel those questions. Well, that's a philosophy thing. So if you think that more people you get, in general, it will increase the accuracy, but there is a certain point that wouldn't change anymore.
Okay, so it's close to 12, so we will conclude the session. Thank you again, thank everyone again for staying this tutorial. So as we mentioned, the materials will be put up online, and the speakers will be around. If you have further questions, we'll be happy to answer. Thank you.